3, 2, 1.
White Noise Boys, listen with your eyes closed.
Hello, everybody. It is Sunday, May the 8th, 2016, and you are listening to the first ever episode of the White Noise Boys. I am your host, Chris Taylor, and with me is... introduce yourself.
Lord Petrie, Aleksandar. You know him as the runner of the Madbox channel on YouTube. Okay, that was a bit of advertising. I'm sorry for that.
That was Carnival Barker as shit. You clearly have never listened to a podcast. You should probably know that your plugs go at the end. Fucking amateur hour up in here.
Well, it is our first episode. I'm sorry.
That's eating true.
Food too.
Oh, God. Nothing ever. Nobody loves more than... into the microphone. Oh, so good. It's my favorite thing when I listen to a podcast, right behind hearing a guy open a beer and it sounds like... But...
or one
<that's>...
of these.
Well, now that we have alienated everybody who... You should mark that, by
Dude,
the
you
way.
Just farted.
Alienated everybody who will listen to our podcast.
Well, I'm glad we got that out of the way.
Alright. So, who the hell are you?
So, yeah, I'm a dabbling developer, just messing around with code, and I'm trying this YouTube thing out. I came from Maine.
Oh, I'm sorry you lived in Maine. Holy shit. How the hell was Maine?
Maine was really, really cold. I don't know. Boring. So, first day of high school, this is a funny story. I love sharing it. I'm in English class. You know, I'm telling everyone where I'm from, what I'm doing, how I live in St. Louis. You know, went to school with 10,000 kids. Here's a school of 1,000 kids. They have no idea.
You also lived in St. Louis, or you on the run?
Dude, no. But I was in St. Louis for 6 months when I first came to the States.
Upstate, dude, St. Louis, max security.
Downtown, no security.
I was implying
I
that you were in prison, not that St. Louis had security.
No, but I did live next to a prison in Maine. Lived in this apartment complex called the Red Bank Village.
Did you get good rent because you lived next to
dude,
a prison?
Dude, I don't know, $700 back in 2006. It was kind of steep.
That's not that much more than I pay. That's not that much less than I pay
right,
where I am
now.
Right,
it's kind of steep. We had a pool, but anyways, yeah, we had a a prison. And the airport, Portland Jetport. So yeah, no, Maine was fun. I'm glad to be out of Maine and in Seattle doing this thing. YouTubing. Anyways. Yeah, I don't know. That's me. Kind of impromptu.
Well, let's see. I lived in Philly. I met my now wife online, and then just said fuck it. We didn't say YOLO back then. Back through the mists of time to 2011, when we did not say YOLO. I just said fuck it. Moved out here. Moved into my wife's apartment. Do some web development. Play a lot of Hearthstone. Try not
Dude,
to hit my
that
baby.
That is the craziest thing for me. Coming from. You know, a third world country, so to speak, that you had met online and actually are, like, in it for what you're doing.
Well, I was working third shift in a warehouse, and I like it. I really get into the zen of repetitive motion tasks. Like, if you have a wedding and you need somebody to lick 20,000 envelopes because for some reason you have that many friends, right?
I would love
to seal all those envelopes. I'm into that. I find there is just like the zen flow state with repetitive motion tasks that I just get really into.
You heard it first here, folks.
So good.
Chris likes to lick envelopes. That is a thing he likes doing.
I mean, you'd have to supply the water because I feel like you get pretty dehydrated after
a while. Oh my god, that's true.
Right?
That's
But yeah, I was working third shift, working third shift, hard to meet people. So I met my wife online on some online
dating.
Dude, what'd
you use?
And Christian Mingle.
No.
No, it's not. But that's my answer that I use whenever I'm asked, because I actually did not meet my wife on a dating site. This one was a site that I was just trawling for hookups at the time.
Oh, that's a lot of fun.
So that's why the go-to answer is christianmingle.com.
Well, because that's just as good as trolling for booty. I mean, I can respect that.
Though sometimes I have said J-date, and when people ask me why J-date because I'm not Jewish, I get to make the joke that there were too many sweater vests on christianmingle.com.
Oh, that's so good. Oh, that's good. That's good. I like that.
But yeah, hard to meet people. Met my wife for a texting for a couple of months, and then I started my lifelong quest to throw away every single object that I own, and moved out here. I came for a visit, actually, about 4 years and 3 days ago exactly.
Wow.
And I came out for a visit because she was gonna fly over here, and then we were gonna drive across the country. And it was Mother's Day weekend, like it is today. It was Mother's Day then, so I flew out, visited, and then decided that I was staying and had to immediately get a job and pay to get all my stuff that I did not throw away shipped here, because all I had was 2 changes of clothes for a while.
Yeah, that's really funny, because my story, and I'm loud again, but my story is kind of similar. I was, finished the whole college thing, spent all my money on that, and then, went back to my college job working third shift. And same thing. Shit just kind of got boring.
Shit happens,
basically.
Life plans do not survive, first contact with the realities of life.
I know. Absolutely.
Speaking of plans where they do not survive reality, I've been I recently graduated from Seattle Central with an associate's in programming, and actually just today submitted my graduation application for a front end, for an Udacity front end nano developer web, nano degree. I get a quarter every time I say that. Actually, that's not true, but it's a great program that I would recommend anyone listening who wants to check out some technical skills, really good. But speaking of things that don't work out right all the time, Knockout JS. I don't know if have you played with Knockout JS
I've
before?
Not played with it, but you mentioned Seattle Central. One of our teachers there is a big proponent for it.
Who's Bill that? Dude. Oh, whatever. It's interesting.
Well,
right?
My question to that is, why then not teach us that? Why pick CodeIgniter? I know it was PHP class, but CodeIgniter is pretty much useless today.
Well.
Dude, no one runs in comparison.
The reason I would teach CodeIgniter, because you could make the argument, my original argument was, if I'm teaching a PHP class, that's already kind of a dead fucking end, right?
True.
Because these days, JavaScript is just consuming the entirety of the internet. But if I were to teach a PHP class, and this is the Web Apps 3, I would want to teach a framework that enforces some sort of design pattern, like a model view controller, a model view view model, right? And back then, when was that?
About a year or two ago.
WordPress had not become 20% of the websites yet.
True, that is also very true.
But so at that point, if I'm not mistaken, CodeIgniter is also RESTful,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's why he taught that. Is it was both RESTful, taught some design patterns, and WordPress had not become this dominant force that it is. So CodeIgniter would have been the thing I would pick. You could see an argument for Cake PHP, but Cake PHP is you don't want to teach some kids that.
Yeah, it's kind of No, I mean I do and
but
I didn't mind it. It's just looking back with how things developed, I would have preferred a class that focused strictly on, or even a curriculum that just did JavaScript work.
Well, the curriculum that we went for at Seattle Central is very different now. Like, when I was going to get my graduation form, I had to go get one of those little brochures, and they had to, like, spend forever looking for the one from 2011 for winter. But these days, like, it's required for you to know, like, inferential statistics and linear analysis.
Wait, they're teaching that at Central? Wow.
Oh, yeah. The stuff on that degree is way different. The degree we graduate on with... totally useless.
Yeah, no, seriously, what the running joke
but
is we can't
I
even get
what, yeah.
the job that Seattle is trying to fill right now.
Yeah, I mean, I feel bad for the person who has 5 years of professional experience demonstrating increasing escalation of responsibility using Drupal.
I know, that is sad.
My heart goes out to you. It's like... people who have that much experience with Drupal, it's like my own personal Haiti earthquake.
Yeah.
Like, my heart goes out to you. I bleed for you. But anyway, back to Knockout. The reason Knockout is dope is in your HTML, you have its comment syntax. It looks like a comment where you say start Knockout, and you can have conditional statements here. So what you do is I'll say if... it's a model view view model, right? So I separate my data from my front end, and then Knockout is the view model, and that handles itself automatically. So I have like a list of objects, right? And I could say for each object, and in my HTML, I specify a chunk of HTML, and that HTML is a template, so it'd be kind of like an Angular element to be reused a whole bunch. And then I can have data binds saying that the text of this element is equal to, I don't know, like this object dot property. So whenever my model changes, the HTML in my view on the web page automatically updates. Those templates are only can be conditionally shown. You can have for eaches and stuff like that. The big advantage of Knockout over something like Angular is Angular's got a huge performance overhead once your web page starts to get a little bigger. And on top of that, Angular, when you use Angular, because you have to declare scope and stuff like that, Angular dictates a lot of the structure of your application, where Knockout doesn't give a fuck. Knockout just says, hey, here's some shit you can do. Figure out all of the rest of it, but here's this new functionality. It doesn't really dictate the structure of your application to you. The downside of Knockout over Angular, though, is that in Angular, you can have scoped contexts, right?
Okay, explain that for those listeners so, that may not be as tech-savvy.
And yourself.
Okay, well, put
and
me
yourself.
On blast. But
well,
that's
for
fine.
The people who aren't... For the people who are not tech savvy, I feel bad for them for this entire segment because we started talking about the PHP.
Okay,
but so the content. So you have
the violin sadness music.
And now that we heard the violin sadness music, you should put a marker there because I'm gonna be really disappointed when you don't edit
okay,
that
well,
in.
Okay, fine. Let me.
I'm gonna keep talking. I'm gonna make it impossible to edit around this so everybody knows that there should have been sad violin music. Hopefully still playing under this entire conversation. You're welcome for that edit. But so in Angular you have your model in all MV, we'll just call them model view whatever patterns. Because almost model view controller, model view, view model, all that shit. Very similar. So in a model view, whatever, you have a model, right? Angular supports nested models. So inside of this model, depending on the state, I might have other ones. So you can have nested contexts. So in your HTML, you have different contexts to refer to. I'm referring to model A, submodel B. Or this one's referring to model B with no submodel, right? I can have multiple contexts. Knockout, you have one. And that's something, that's a price you pay for not having model dictate the structure of your application to you. But it's not very good at telling you that, and it's very hard to debug. The best Knockout debug tool, what did Bill Newman tell you to do when something didn't work wrong in PHP? What'd you do?
When something didn't work correctly in PHP, shit, Google it?
Mm-hmm. You pre-tag, var dump,
oh, yeah. Dump
and
die,
pre-tag.
That's right. Dump and die.
Dump, die. And you know what? That's what you do when
that's
you have
gotta be
Knockout.
The best function in the world. Dump and die.
Well, honestly, it's like a statement of purpose for my entire life. I exist to eat good food and then take a bunch of dumps and I'll eventually die.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's perfect. Exactly for that reason. Thank you for elaborately painting that picture.
Nope. No problem.
I'm glad you've done that. Dumping and dying. Yeah, so knockout.
It's pretty good. The only thing is, as if you're in my boat and you're an aspiring developer, I probably would not recommend you learn Knockout. Not because it's bad, but because it's not popular anymore. Because Knockout existed before Angular, and Angular has consumed. I mean, now it's just basically Angular. Maybe everybody wants React, but that's because in Model View Controller, you can use React with almost anything because React functions as your view. So you can use React with Angular, with Knockout.
So it's a good, an accessory or a utility app.
Yeah, it's a
builder.
Yeah, it's the totally. It's the V in your model view, whatever. Every time. So since I'm let's go back to Knockout, right? Knockout is my view model. My model is just my data. So I could use my data, Angular and not Angular, React and Knockout, no problem, mm-hmm. right? So, but the problem, the reason I wouldn't recommend Knockout is since Angular came out, all you're really gonna see these days, people either want you to know Angular, Ember, which I don't know anything about.
That one's
about,
an old one. Well, I mean, not too old, but still.
Ember caught on because it was one of the first ones, so a lot of places that are really entrenched with the technology stack still use it. But these days, for blue sky projects, most people go Angular. And Angular 2 is actually coming out, and I'm going to look into learning some TypeScript for it, which I'm excited about because looking at it, it's just strictly typed JavaScript with a very firm handle on this. So basically, it is JavaScript for people like me who come from strictly typed object-oriented languages like C#.
Nice. Well, I'm glad
so I'm hype about that.
Okay.
You don't need to learn TypeScript to use Angular. Angular 1.1, it's just that the Angular 2 beta has started, and right now it's TypeScript only.
Shit, all that tells me is that I have a lot of catching up to do.
I would just focus on regular old Angular right now, because you know who doesn't like to be an adopter of bleeding-edge technologies? Is companies.
Well, unless you yeah, that's actually funny, because so the company I work for, we're talking a little bit about that front-end developer position.
Do you like them enough to plug it?
Well, no, so the headquarters, the overarching developers.
Sorry, I was very amused by the no.
No, but they use Perl. I know,
oh, God.
I know. So they, the Seattle office, they're all about Angular and Django and whatever, and some of them are trying to move some things to the mean stack, but I don't know, we might be losing some more folks, because
I don't want to put you on blast, but I would like to point out that the A in mean stands for Angular, so they're all
true,
about
true,
Angular.
And I did know that. I've been playing way too many games, aka just one game excessively.
Oh? What have you been playing?
Warband, of course. You put me onto that.
How the Swadian filth been treating you? Sorry to all the Swadians.
So for the Swads, as I've called them, the Sweds, Swedes, Sweats, Swass? Yeah, I'll call them Swamp Ass.
Oh, come on, dude. The white dudes. Not
yeah,
all
but
white
no,
dudes,
you're
but
right.
The dudes with the white nations, they're the Swedes.
Them. So they're down to one castle.
Oh, the Swadians?
They are down to one castle.
Yeah.
But there's almost 800 dudes in there at any given moment.
So let's talk about Warband, because Warband is not a game that everyone and their mother has played.
Which is a sad thing to hear, because everyone should in their lifetime.
I think the reason they haven't, though, is because it's ugly as fuck and looks
Dude,
so
it
janky.
Does, but yeah, it's, well, maybe because I'm so old, right? I mean, I'm 28, so I'm an 80s baby.
Jesus, how the fuck do you crawl out of your coffin every
Dude,
day?
By playing old school games, reminding myself of the greatness. That was SNES and Genesis, and my favorite actually is the Chinese bootleg that came preloaded with like 900,000 games. After about the first 10, they were all the same with different color schemes.
And like, yeah, like 50 of them are Tetris clones.
And then you got about 100 different Mario Tetris pill. If you've ever seen this, it's a Mario Tetris game where you're basically matching different pill colors.
Okay, this game has a name and it's called
Dr.
Mario.
Yeah, oh, thank you for...
come on.
Yeah, Dr. Mario, dude. Seriously, take your pills, kids.
I don't think that dude's a licensed doctor, because that ain't how you, like, you get the flu and Mario's like, hey, check out these 700
pills. Yeah, just
pills.
Take these sugar pills. Which, quick segue, one of my coworkers is taking these multivitamins, and I shit you not, out of the, like, 10 different ingredients in the ingredient list, the first 8 were just gelatin, sugar, and then water. So basically, you're just drinking sugar pills with some B12 vitamins.
Or you could not take vitamins, save your money, and not care because you're going to fucking die one
exactly.
day anyway. And you might as well spend that money on something you enjoy like cigarettes instead of vitamins.
Or video games, you know, because sitting down increases chance of death too because, you know, that's fun. But yeah, Warband, SWADs. Yeah, I'm going to have to take a pause on that. And for those of you watching, if you're interested, check me out, the Madbox channel on YouTube. I'm gonna do this throughout our YouTube.
Please save all your plugs. Still
I'm gonna
then.
Try, but
you're killing
this
me.
This was appropriate.
Mm-hmm. Now, okay, it's not like people are gonna magically stumble upon this podcast without
Dude,
knowing about
you
your
never
YouTube
know.
Channel.
Anyways, okay. Yeah. So right now I'm in war with the Sultanate. The dudes in the desert, because I keep raping their villages.
And what's it? So you're at war, so you fight some battles. What's it like when you fight a battle? Because you have not told me anything about Warband.
Okay, so and I'm definitely gonna play some videos to showcase. But Warband is a lot of fun because it's difficult.
In three words.
In that the mechanic is unlike any other game. I mean, it's responsive, right? You know, you as you swing, you gotta control your swings. There's a lot of, what do you want to call it? Speed-related things, like if you do a charge.
You're bad at this. You're very bad at this.
Yeah,
I'm
going to have
here.
To get better, and hopefully I will.
All right, so the majority of Warband, the way I would describe the majority of Warband is like a medieval simulator. It's not like a Crusader Kings 2. Crusader Kings 2 came out, clearly it took a lot from Warband in terms of the politicking side, right? That's relatively minor. You'll spend the majority of your You'll spend the majority of your time in these army encounters, right? And the way that works is you get, before the battle, you've sorted all your troops. You might roll into battle with, say, like 50 footmen and like 20 archers and some cavalry, right? And the way it works is you move with the WASD keys, and you have directional attacking with various weapons. So I click, drag my mouse to the left, and I swing to the left. If I drag it to the right, I swing to the right. If I drag it down, I do like a poke if your weapon has a poke attack. So like axe is not good at that, but you have overhead swings. A lot of it's based on the direction you're moving. And when he was talking about speed, you can get on a horse, right? So damage is not only based on the strength of your weapon, the strength of your character, but a lot of the combat is momentum based. So if I get on a horse and I have this axe and I'm running at you and I run into your horse, not going to do a lot of damage. But if I go by the side of your horse and hit you with my swing as I go by, probably going to just instantly kill you or your horse, depending on my weapon, right? Because your momentum acts as like a modifier for the base damage of your weapon.
That was...
Then there's a lot of cool stuff where you have, based on troop types, I can say, all my archers stand here, fire my arrows, and fire in a volley or fire at will. And you have a lot of tactics. tactical control over your army. I could say all my infantry, group up, advance 10 paces, hold here, wait for the enemy to get close, have my archers fire a volley, and then send my cavalry off. And then when my cavalry have started to clip them on the flanks, that's when you let your infantry go. And then you just wait in there and like chop motherfuckers, and you just listen to 300 dudes all yell in the same voice going, "Ah!" And that's the Mountain Warblade. That's the Mountain Blade Warband experience.
That was basically, yes, that was it. Beautifully said. I mean, I couldn't have done it better myself. Yeah. As we saw. And, you know, hopefully I'll get better as these podcasts go on, right? With the help of my homie Chris. But yeah, that's Warband.
I would argue that you're my homie and not the other way around.
Fair enough.
Whatever.
we did come to... To Seattle around the same time. Actually, my 3-year anniversary is going to be in 2 days.
Oh, fucking plebe. I've been here for 4 years. Even actually,
dude,
five
did you just really call me 2011. Plebe? Come on.
I did, dude, call you plebe. Plebe is shorthand for plebeians, which are the lower working class. They're the Starbucks barista. The Starbucks baristas,
yeah,
of Rome.
Well, as soon as you said plebeians,
and much...
Got what you're talking about.
So what have you been up to in Warband? Now that I've described
so
the game.
So now
you're
that you've told our audience what this game is about, and yeah, so I have another maybe 30 hours of footage that I'm gonna cut before I actually start playing. But right now, currently, we took over our first city. That was a big decision to make, since I really liked having the Nords pay for my military, which, if you do decide to play Warband, and first thing you should do is download the Floris Evolved mod. It's going to improve your gameplay a hundredfold, I would say. The game itself, the vanilla game, the AI sucks. I mean,
the AI is not that much better.
I mean, it's not, but, you know...
The reason it feels better, you take a lot more damage.
Right, which, you know, even when you set it to the easiest setting, which, you know, sadly I may have done.
Sorry about that.
Yeah,
no
worries. But yeah, even if you do that, it's still pretty good. And so I would download it. It has the politics, right? The diplomacy mod, which is pretty great. And overall, I mean,
yeah,
it's really what the
like
game should have been.
You couldn't even... Yeah, you couldn't even be a king in vanilla.
Really, that's really, yeah. I mean, it's not even worth playing.
The best you could do is pledge yourself to a lord and then, like, conquer the world in his name.
Which, you know what I don't like? So I play as a female character, right? I really wanted that real experience, which... Newsflash to you, you know, if you might be one of those SJVs or something like that. The game is punishing to a female character to be time accurate.
What does the acronym SJV stand for? Sorry, I gotta roll back.
Do you
here.
Not
what
know
does
this?
That stand for?
Okay, well.
Oh no, I know what the acronym really is, and I'm curious about what your acronym means.
Social Justice Warriors? What did you think I was gonna say?
Yeah, well, you said SJVs, and I'm like, I wonder what that's
about. You know, not to, you know, to each their own, and definitely conversations that need to happen, and so on and so forth. But,
So for the record, you are not allowed to refer to Social Justice Warriors on this podcast, because the people, Social Justice Warrior is a derogatory term for people who aren't assholes.
Really? I hope that doesn't paint me.
That is an insulting term that is meant to insult people and categorize people who care about things like, oh, I don't know, women.
Oh, well, see, I did not know
they're assholes. When people use it, it's because they're mad that other people want them to be there.
And maybe that just speaks to my ignorance, which, you know, ignorance is bliss, just like chocolate, which, you know, I'm a big fan. So, anyways, non sequitur. But not to don't judge my character on that. I wasn't you know.
I don't know if that's why I banned it.
Cause yeah, but basically yeah, the game's supposed to be harder, and so you can't really become a vessel that gets property as a female character, which is another sort of depressing thing, but at the same time it makes it more fun. But back to the point of strategy early on, along with being a vessel, you can become a mercenary, which is what I was doing. And it's basically infinite monies for your troops, so it was fun to get that paid for. And now that I no longer have it, you know, we'll see how it goes.
And you know what the worst part is too, is that the easiest way to make your money is by pillaging the villages of your opponents. But when you do that and you take over the castle associated with that village ain't gonna give you shit in taxes because they don't have any money because you already took
right.
It
so there is an impact on the economy.
So you're just shooting yourself in the if you need the money that bad. And so like if you're playing a mercenary, right, you're like at war all the time making hella money because you don't give a fuck about the people in that
nobody
village,
yeah,
right? But the second you become your own kingdom, instead of engaging in war, you're suddenly spending a lot of time sitting at home because you need to make money the old-fashioned way through taxes, because if you do a lot of looting and pillaging, not only does that slowly degrade your right to rule, but it also makes it harder to earn money in the future when that village falls under your
right
banner.
And eventually the whole point of the game, depending on how far you take it, is to conquer everything, right? So if you do that, if you do conquer everything, it'll get a little tricky. Because there was a point at which so the Sultanate is my mortal enemy. I am they're
the
yellow ones,
red.
They're in the desert.
Or are they the purple ones? The purples are the
yes,
Kurgans.
And the greens are the Rodoks. They've been my friends. There's a point in the game where I was still fighting for the Nords. They're the baby blues, which I think is really funny. But anyways, they're fighting with the Rodoks for properties taken and conquered on both sides. And so they were constantly fighting at one point. And so it got really troublesome because the Nords were friends with everyone else. So I was running out of money, running out of food, because I didn't want to ruin my relationship with the Greens, with the Rodoks. Aren't they the ones that have the elephant archers?
The elephant, I think, is the Swadians. The Rodoks are spearmen.
Okay. But I'm cool with them. It'll get interesting once I start trying to conquer that, though. That'll be...
They're hard to conquer if just because of the way the map is geographically shaped in that area. They're kind of in a U, where all if you were to draw a U on a piece of paper, where your line is made by the pencil is passable terrain, but everywhere else is mountain. So it's very hard to get up in there, because if they pull all their armies in there, you don't have a lot of room for maneuvering, and you have to grind through their entire military force.
Yeah, I can see that as being a little troubling. Absolutely. We'll see. So my plan is to cut maybe five more episodes. I'm on episode 9, so we'll see how much, you know. I'm cutting out a lot of material. I mean, it's my first go at the whole thing, so
it's amazing how you have died 0 times in your videos. You're so good at video games,
dude. I can't describe them, but I play them epically. If that's even a word.
That was more a joke about your editing, and I assumed that you were just editing out all the times that you were bad.
You know, not so much. I actually, this next video I'm gonna put out, number 9, does have me die to a bunch of bandits. So I'm at a point where they're banding into their own little leadership groups.
Oh, dude, you gotta shit up. So, in each area now, I don't know if you've seen this, but our bandit
Yes,
players...
and I've not been crushing them because I was hoping at one point that I was gonna get the quests, you know, just to get my reputations up.
Nope. Because what happens is they spawn a group of bandits every once in a while, and if you let them go, that's how the bandit armies get
yes.
bigger.
Yes, so right now, I don't know if you... Are you familiar with Rolf?
Yeah, Ralph the Bandit King. He is, like, impossible
Dude,
to capture.
Tell me about him.
But what I like to do, what's good about that, is because manhunters and slave drivers will try to hunt bandits, but they'll run. But the AI for them is bad. This is during the world simulation, because we failed to mention that when you're not in battle, the entire game is a continually running simulation with all of the AI factions taking action and stuff like that. If you really like this game, by the way, dude, you should check out Crusader Kings 2. I think you're going to
so,
really
love that.
So,
but isn't
that
a text-based
more...
one?
No. It's more focused on the politics and court intrigue. Like, I assassinated my 5-year-old brother one time.
Because I think I played the first one. It was, like, on... it had, like, really shitty requirements.
But... If you let the bandits go, because bandits are high count, low quality troops, but you can grind through a whole bunch of them. If you beat them, you free a million captives, and it's just basically a restock your army to max capacity for.
I know. Free. I did like them for that. I did. Killing the bandits.
Not to mention, if you have high points in surgery, bandit weapons are unlikely to kill your troops and just wound them. So they're just like massive experience farms. So I usually just let them go.
Yeah, I don't mind them. I mean, so back to being a queen of Caladia. Keep messing up that name.
I think it's just Caladia, by the way.
Well,
if you need to pronounce it like a douche.
Well, whatever. But right now, so having your own kingdom, the perk. So the downside being you gotta pay to be the boss. The upside is you can. Right now, I have like 230 dudes in my military group following me around, and so.
I bet that gets expensive.
I mean, dude, I make enough money. I started investing into lands and all that. So the Florist mod also lets you buy land in the different towns, and you get.
Don't borrow money, by the way. It's worse of a deal than it is in real
life.
Oh,
yeah, no. There's no reason to. You can just pillage a bunch of villages. At the end of the day, you know, just pillage the village. If you know, we need monies. Nobody cares.
Get monies.
But, yeah, so pillaging is pretty fun. Makes you money. Where were we? Yeah, 230. So yeah, I got all manhunters. So that means a lot of slaves.
That is a winning strategy.
I know.
Thank
you for that. Absolutely.
It's just you're welcome. The only thing you gotta watch out for, you want to be like slave crushers, and once you get a bunch of slave crushers, dude, you just roll over everything.
Yeah, you did. You put me onto that, and it's doing wonders. And, yeah, so to troop trees...
That's how I inevitably...
What?
Oh, yeah.
So, the original game's troop trees are kind of pretty shitty from a standpoint that if all you had were, what, rank 2 Nordsmen, the Harlaskar or whatever, you could just run train, literally, because of their...
Oh, the Huskarls? Yeah.
Yeah, so that's not... I mean, they're still pretty OP in a way... Just not as much.
So, the Huskarls were OP in vanilla because they had the best shields in the game and the best body armor in the game, so they just tanked everything, and their axe was okay. Their weapon wasn't amazing, but they were just so tanky that, if you had, like, a core of, like, 20 of those, they would last the whole battle, even in a castle siege. And in Forest Mod, what they did is they really went and created a million kinds of, like, shields and armor. So there's a lot more fine grating in there where there wasn't before. So the Huskarls, now their shields are wide, but they don't have a lot of hit points, so they go down pretty easily. After, because their shields are very breakable. So they're way less overpowered, but man, that was how you won in vanilla. You just got Huskarls.
Yeah, and that's, so when I first started doing the game, I hadn't really realized the changes. So that's why I kind of, I was starting on the Nord side, being like, let's get them in, get the Huskarls, whatever. And, you know, I learned pretty early on that was not gonna get me results. But yeah, they're not as good. They're still pretty. I mean, I would say they're still probably the best starting. Like when you just start out, to get a bunch of them.
Yeah, if only because low-tier cavalry is ineffective, and they spawn on the opposite side of the map from the cavalry-based factions. So all you gotta focus on is your infantry.
Right, and that'll get you to a point where you can pretty well defend yourself against cavalry, which, if you are, here's a pro tip, if you are in a fight against a cavalry-based army, try to run away to the hills before they catch up to you, if you can.
Yeah, because it slows them down going up the hill. Yeah,
basically, slows down the charge. I mean, it could even, I mean, I would say 8 out of 10 times it'll probably win you the fight. And if not, there's always battle size. yeah, don't abuse the battle size. And for those of you who don't know, there's a setting that determines how big the battles can be. The max is 150, the minimum is 30. So if you're facing, say, a size 600 army and you only have, you know, 100 dudes, you could try to sway the odds in your favor by changing that.
So the problem with that is that you can actually fuck yourself a lot harder than you think you can, because battle advantage is a real factor. So what your battle advantage is if you have a battle advantage of minus 10, that means the enemy you are fielding 10 less. If a zero battle advantage would be a 30-on-30 battle based on your battle size, if you have a battle advantage of negative 10, it's 40-on-20. So by turning down the battle size in a 1,000 versus 100, they might be fielding 99 when you're fielding 1, when if you had the battle size at max, you would at least be fielding 100. You're still outnumbered 10 to 1.
Your odds are better. No, and that's absolutely true. Troops. I had come to find that out the hard way. And another pro tip, this game will punish you more, and I don't mean that in a good way anyways, yeah, the game is really brutal, it's really unforgiving, and it's almost not even worth messing around with that.
Okay, well, I think that's a lot of time spent.
I know, I really like the game, dude. Thank you for
again.
Thank you for
no problem, dude. It's so, I played that game for like 100-200 hours. I got my Steam open. Let's
oh,
let's
dude, yeah.
Go
let me open up my Steam too. Just for comparison, we'll end
Mount
it. I think we can
Blade.
End it on this note.
Let's see, the original Mountain Blade, I have 32 hours played, and then on Warband, I have 89 hours played, so I have 121 hours played between the two.
Dude, nice. My Steam is updating right now, damn it. Is there final words on Warband?
Okay, well, we...
For me, well... I was going to say, Warband 2 is coming out, Bannerlord. I almost have to get that game when it comes out, but they don't have a release date yet. I mean, they hyped it up really, really a lot.
I would argue they didn't hype it up and that they just released a trailer and you are hype.
Well, no, there's been some gameplay footage. There's like 30 minutes of gameplay footage.
But is that hyping it up? Or is that just saying, hey, check out this cool game we're making? I would argue that you are unable to control your game boner.
You know, maybe that's a fair argument to make. I mean, maybe.
Well, I think we'll leave. What's exciting about Warband 2?
Better graphics. I think the engine. I don't even know what engine they're going to release that on. But I think the battles are going to be a lot.
I know
more
the original
epic.
Warband was. Oh yeah, I know the original was a custom. They rolled their own.
I don't know if they're rolling.
And
they
I'm
might
sure
be rolling
the
their
reason.
Own, but. From the looks of it, the siege battles were a lot better. The AI during siege battles, mm-hmm. Oh my god, it annoys me so much, man. I can't even, like, just watching my companions get shot up with arrows as I'm the only one that pushes that stupid siege cart.
Oh, it's custom again, by
oh,
the way.
Oh, damn. But they are going to open it up to modding, so, I mean, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
So that'll, you know.
That's a big advantage of a custom engine is that you are not limited to how moddable something like an, for example, nobody uses it anymore, but an Unreal 3 engine, right? There's so much of that core engine is decided for you. It makes sense that it's a custom engine because they're so focused on entity count. Right? Because that's what makes the game feel the way it is battle sizes and the sheer number of actors running around all with their own AI. And that's why the original game looks so fucking ugly. It's like the Dwarf Fortress thing. Do you want complexity and size or do you want it to look nice? And given that the Warband is fairly old and computers have come a long way in that time, looks like they're finally hitting it on both ends. Yeah, it does look really good. I'll probably get it eventually, maybe not right away. I don't know, man. I don't know why, but I'm less excited. I know maybe because I know I will play it eventually, so I just don't feel the need to be super hype about it.
I mean, I'm hype. Yeah, no.
It's because you're in that moment. You're in love with the game as it is right now. It's understandable that you would be hype because, you'd be hype about the game you're still playing, right? Like, I'm already done with Warband, which is probably why I'm less hyped about it.
True, yeah, that's a pretty good point. And plus, I've not, another news flash, I've not played very many games in the last good, I don't know, probably 5 years. I've been on the, I've been a slave to the console since I couldn't really afford a gaming PC, and not that I have necessarily a gaming PC now, but I have one that can at least handle itself a little better.
Yeah. Spoilers, the idea that a gaming PC is expensive is a myth.
No, I know, but my life is a little bit expensive.
Right, well, that's what I'm saying. Like, even a reasonable laptop, like, you could go play, like, a game like Fez right now. There are so many games you could play right now. You don't... Gaming PCs are only super expensive if you need to play. If you feel the need to play something like The Witcher 3 on max settings.
Yeah, but how much more fun is that though?
Well, that's the point.
Right.
that's what I'm saying. That's why gaming PCs are expensive is a myth.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. No. And I mean, what, $1,000 could run you
also,
pretty.
Also, you ruined.
Pretty good, right?
You ruined my segue.
Your segue?
Yeah.
All right. What?
Okay. You know what? Let's ruin a segue and let's talk about a segue, because nothing makes a segue is a smooth transition between two parts of a conversation. So nothing ruins a segue like talking about a segue. But you ruined my segue into The Witcher 3.
Well. Can I apologize
so,
for that?
Speaking of the Witcher 3.
Dude, that's an old... Alright, in my defense, that's kind of an old game.
Are you... Are you kidding me?
Okay, no, you're right.
Says the guy playing Mountain Blade Warband. When did Mountain Blade Warband come out? Nothing is more. This is gonna be really good audio because I'm gonna Google Mountain Blade Warband.
It's 2010, dude. You don't have to Google that. I can tell you.
Blade Warband. Okay, yeah, The Witcher 3 came out like mid.
It's current. I mean, it's current.
So, the other reason it's current, too, is that they're still adding DLC to it.
Oh, no shit.
Oh, yeah. No. So, I played Witcher 3 last year. I probably played it for, like, 130 hours. Mm. It is a big, big game. So, The Witcher 3, for anybody who doesn't know about it, which would be weird, given that this is one of the best-selling, best-reviewed games of last year. Not that any of that means jack-fucking-shit, but it happens to be a very...
I mean, it says a lot. It doesn't mean anything, you know, it's just empty talk, but, you know, it says a lot.
Uh-huh. So, it's a...
Sorry. Dude, is your name on Steam Word Puncher? Really?
Hey, you know what?
It just popped
up.
I like it.
Damn it, I should have gone offline. Now you're going to know I'm playing a video game.
It's okay, dude. I've been making the channel art for our YouTube channel for this entire
time. Hold up, I don't want to play on suicidal mode. You know what? I'm going to turn this off because I get really invested in killing Floor 2. But The Witcher 3 is kind of this... It's a third person. It play a little bit like a Devil May Cry. It's more like it's a third person hack and slash game, except it's not just a hack and slash game like something like a God of War. There's a lot of focus on your defensive verbs, right? So like you have spells, you have strong weak attacks, you have blocking, parrying, sidestepping, and rolling. So you have, and then you, on top of that, you have crossbows, bombs, throwable items, and you have like 7 different kinds of bombs, 5 different kinds of spells. So you have a lot of options, right? So you just have this massive combat toolbox. It's very Soulsy in that way, actually, in that the combat. So I played this game before, right? But it's like a third-person action game where you have a really wide tool set. I would compare it to something like a Souls game where the damage, the numbers in terms of the damage that's dealt back and forth is a little bit lower, and the game runs faster. So there's not a focus on high risk per swing, but rather you still have this really wide verb set, and you improvise the whole way through combats, right? So that's the combat in the game. The rest of the game is this massive, and I mean fucking massive, open world game, right? The game's enormous. So there's like this main plot line, and it's very, very long. You could probably beat the game in like 40 hours. I mean, it's an RPG. It's pretty long. The whole thing is based on novels. The story, they're okay. They're like Polish novels? Yeah, CD Projekt. It's the games from CD Projekt Red.
They're from Poland. So I just about them. And so not necessarily the game, but they started out as like a.
They own Good Old Games.
Yeah, and they. What I love about them and The Witcher, specifically, they that game, the second one, got pirated more than any other game. Ever?
Oh, The Witcher 3.
No, the second one. I know.
Oh, Witcher 2.
And, I mean, because they only made, like, 5 million on The Witcher 2.
They also spent significantly less than that, so who cares?
And
that's kind of their MO, right? Like, they started as Good Old Games, then they were making a lot of money, then they made The Witcher, which was relatively small and unknown, and then The Witcher did better than they expected, so they took all that money, reinvested it into The Witcher 2, and then did the same thing with Witcher 2 for Witcher 3. Witcher 3 is the biggest, most ambitious open-world game that I have
really?
Ever played, right? If I did not like Persona 3 so much...
Oh, so is that you're a little biased towards Persona?
Yes. Dude. So when I play games, I listen to a lot of podcasts. I tend to enjoy a game that I either want a really short, focused experience, something very linear, very crafted, doesn't have to be short, but I prefer it. So, like, I'm the dude who really likes Call of Duty campaigns whenever I play a Call of Duty, which is not very often. I think the last one I played was Black Ops 2. But, like, I like games that are, usually prefer games that are designed first. But when I play a game that's not designed first, I like it to be really systemic and of a game, where it's very systems driven and of a type that I can just grind on for a while. And Persona 3 was really cool because it had that and it had some roguelike elements. And what's cool about The Witcher 3 is just that there's so much there. The dialogue is, there's really good voice acting, really good music, the story. There's,
I hear they also have epic sex scenes too.
Oh god, they're so bad. They're so bad. So, The Witcher, not very good at gender issues, by the way. In the original Witcher, you could, like, pay and bang a hoe, like, some just prostitute off the street corner, and then you got a trading card with her picture on it, and you collected trading cards of all the chicks you
bought. Dude, alright. Funny tidbit, side note, Dennis Rodman used to collect Playboy trading cards. He paid $2 million for the Carmen Electra one.
I don't know.
Not important at all.
I don't know who Dennis
Rodman
is.
Dude, what? The
So, I don't
Bulls?
I don't know.
Dude,
the
Bulls?
Go ahead.
You don't know about the Bulls in the 90s?
I'm aware of the Bulls in the 90s, but no one gives a shit about anyone who wasn't Michael Jordan or Scottie.
Dude, my favorite was Dennis Rodman. He's the guy that went to North Korea to talk to Kim or Kim's son, whatever. Alright, well, anyways, whatever, non sequitur.
Hey, dude, you gotta collect what you gotta collect, as we'll talk about later. We'll talk about my ridiculous Hearthstone card collection.
Oh, dude,
days,
mine sucks. Speaking of, I have to kind of open that at some point today.
Okay, well, maybe we'll do a stream afterward. But anyway, so the thing, have you ever played an open world RPG before? Like you play like Skyrim or something like that?
Dude, really? Are you kidding me? I fell in love with open world RPGs. I would say probably when I played Morrowind, the third Elder Scrolls game. And
don't go back and play that again.
No, I can't. I want to.
It does not hold
up. I'm not going to lie. Sometimes I want to, but it does not hold up at all. I mean,
there's a mod for Oblivion where they basically completely remade Morrowind inside of Oblivion, and that's pretty playable.
Yeah, I heard they wanted to do that for Skyrim. I didn't really like Oblivion. I don't know. It didn't. Maybe again, because I didn't have the machine to play it on that could really sustain it.
Oblivion is, there's a lot of things that are really good about Oblivion, but Oblivion is the most generic setting. It's just generic European fantasy, like your Tolkien's and whatnot. Like Morrowind was really, really unique in terms of the environment and the things you ran into. And Skyrim was less unique. It was mostly herf-a-derf Viking RPG. But Skyrim made up for it by mastering all of the systems. And Oblivion had some system problems and was boring looking, which is why a lot of people would look at Oblivion as like the stepchild of the Elder
Scrolls.
Yeah,
it was off-putting in a way because of that. Whereas, exactly, with Morrowind,
so
I mean, the story was there
for me.
Think
like Skyrim. You keep derailing
Sorry.
Me, brother.
You know, I'm pretty good at that.
Try to talk about The Witcher. So, the thing about, like, Skyrim, right? Like, every quest you get is go into this cave, kill this skeleton, and then get this fucking dope sword, right? And that's all there is to a lot of it. And The Witcher, like, every single quest has, like, a really well-written micro-story around it. And with the voice acting being so good, the story's really good. The main character himself, Geralt, kind of a flop. He's kind of like just real gruff, generic. But the world is really interesting. The setting's very interesting. Like, you're playing the majority of the game in a neutral middle ground between, like, massive powers at war. So the setting's really unique. The game's really good. I've been playing it on the hardest difficulty because I played it before. And, you know, you just kind of tappa your way through the game because on that difficulty. So imagine, what if you played Skyrim on the hardest difficulty and when you rested, you didn't recover any health. So you had to, like, be actively, like, constantly eating a ton of food to regenerate health and shit like that. And it gets really brutal. The combat, I've been finding out, is actually really deep. You just never realize that on a normal difficulty because you're not required to realize that. And I've been really enjoying the game. Once I finish the main campaign, I'll probably get the DLCs. They're like $15 a pop. But they're expandalones, meaning that they're expansions for the game, but can be played. I think they can be played standalone even if you don't own The Witcher 3.
Really?
And apparently, Yeah, a lot of people apparently like the DLCs more than the main game, so I'm very excited about that, because I think the main game's really dope, but I've been playing that, grinding on that. What else have I played this week? I played a little bit of Final Fantasy Record Keeper, and I would say don't play that game.
Yeah, so why not? Here's my Final Fantasy story, right? I played Final Fantasy way back, maybe like the fourth one. I remember it was on 7 discs. It was on PlayStation 1. I didn't have a PlayStation, so I had to pay like 50 cents an hour to play.
Did your dude have blonde hair or
black hair? I think.
Okay, so you played Final Fantasy 8.
Whatever. It was 7, actually. Yeah, 7.
Well, then your dude's blonde. Did your sword also have a gun in it?
No, I don't even remember. I played literally for like 2 hours running around this one map. I couldn't figure out what to do, and it was like 7 more discs, and I was just like, dude, I thought, you know, I don't really want to spend my money on this. I'm paying these people to play this game that it's just like, you know what? I could be playing Mario Kart or GoldenEye. This was in the 90s, right? I mean, this was. It was not fun. Can I just say it was not fun? And leave it at that. You know, it wasn't too bad, but I just wasn't about it. But outside of that, then maybe early 2000s, right? I started getting into ROMs, right? Because I'm all about bootlegs. And sue me if you want, but I don't like to buy too many games, or at least back then I didn't. So I got the Final Fantasy Advance for Game Boy Advance on the bootleg, and I really enjoyed that game, right? That was, what do they call those, RTSs or something?
What?
Did you listen to any of what I said? Final Fantasy Advance, what do they call them?
Okay, Final Fantasy Tactics Advance. An RTS is something like a StarCraft. The R means real.
Oh, real time. Okay. Real time
strategy game, and that's probably I would call that a turn-based tactical game. There's a division when you're describing a strategy game between a strategy game, a grand strategy game, and a tactical game. So something like StarCraft, right? That's a strategy game. But something like XCOM, the smaller focus stuff where you have like 6 units with rich actions versus another small number of units, rather than being on the army scale, it's on the individual scale. That's a tactical game. So I would call that a turn-based tactical RPG.
So a turn-based tactical RPG. Okay, I like that. I mean, I can, you know, whatever. That sounds pretty legit. You know, it was a fun game. I enjoyed the storyline. The fact that basically you were just some invalid child that wanted his mommy back. I don't know, that sounded really, really
spoilers,
bad.
That's like, well, spoilers, that's like all of Final Fantasy.
So you mean to tell me that Square Enix or whatever is just a bunch of dudes missing their mom? I mean, it is Mother's Day, so I guess it's kind of appropriate, you know, happy Mother's Day.
You've seen an anime before. All animes, they either miss their mother or their mother is dead.
So that's kind of like a perfect thing for me. No, I'm just kidding. But anyways, yeah. So what's the one you're playing now?
So I played like all the Final Fantasy game. I'm not playing this game anymore, by the way. I fucking uninstalled this game. So it's like a free-to-play phone game, and it's you're playing through moments in all of the stories of all the Final Fantasy games, and there's some cool stuff, like the 3D games, like Final Fantasy 10 or 12 or 13 or whatever. All their enemies and stuff are done in pixel art, so it's a cool reinterpretation of those characters, and you're playing through, like, some dungeons and stuff. But the problem is, it's so... So you can play probably for 2 hours on the first day uninterrupted before the energy meter gets you.
Wait, so explain that
right?
to me.
It has an energy meter. So what happens is I'll pick a moment, right? So it might be like Final Fantasy VII, the beginning of the game where you go into the Mako reactor, right? And that might be separated out into four battles. And each battle has three waves of enemies. So you're fighting like six battles per section. And you have four sections, and the last one is in the boss. But every section costs you stamina out of an energy meter. And when you run out, you can either pay or put it down for another day.
So you mean to tell me they integrated?
Oh yeah, no,
microtransactions.
It's a free-to-play Final Fantasy game. Oh, total. It's a free-to-play game. That's what that means. A free-to-play game does not mean a game that's free. It means that a game that you either play for 10 minutes a day or pay a bunch of money. With the exception of something like Hearthstone. Most free-to-play games are hot garbage with energy meters. But, so the problem is, I played this for like a couple of days. I haven't put any money into it. But, it's so easy. There's an auto battle button, which just makes all your dudes melee attack. And even with two mages in my party who do like no damage, they'll do like 12 damage, where like I have like Cloud in my party from Final Fantasy 7, and then I have a dude from two dudes from Final Fantasy 4. So you build a party across all the games, which is kind of cool if you like the characters, they have their moves and stuff from the
other
games.
Yeah, that does sound kind of cool. So
but
it kind of combines.
It's kind of cool, except for the part where even though Cloud might do 500 damage and my mages only do 12, and I have two, and I've been playing this for 3 days, the game is still so easy. I've done nothing but press auto battle and then watch my characters fight, and then the three sets of fights go on so long that my phone's screen turns off.
Wow.
And I've done literally nothing but watch this game play itself. This game is fucking garbage.
So you've basically spent 3 days and burnt your phone's battery to watch some shitty movies.
It's also, the whole thing is sprite art, but it runs so slow. Like, as a web developer, I push a button, and I expect something to happen within 100 milliseconds. Because if it takes any longer than that, people notice it. And it takes like 3 seconds for it to do anything, and I'm just
so. So, do you think that they, as a development team, Square Enix, and where they're at,
it's not Square Enix.
What? So it's not even
this. Square Enix did not give enough of a shit about this game to make it themselves. It is so slow, and it's just really unoptimized. Because I have a very nice smartphone. I have an HTC M9, which. Very, very nice. And it burns through my whole battery in like an hour and a half, despite being a sprite art game. So this game is just an unoptimized hot pile of garbage.
Huh.
And on top of that, you do nothing but watch it play itself. I do not recommend this game in any way. I might recommend it. I might recommend adding it to a list, but only if that list is a list of games that you should not play.
That's a fun list to have. Yeah, absolutely. I downloaded, speaking of downloadable games, I downloaded Clash Royale Arena or whatever. Yeah, have you played that?
I play a lot of it, actually.
Let's form a clan, because you recommended
I uninstalled it. I uninstalled it because I needed to get, like, all my life back.
I got really,
really into that game. So, have you seen the list of arenas yet?
I had taken a look at some of them.
I made it to the max level arena.
Wow.
Like, I played that game competitively. I showed up on some pro streams. I got way into that game in a hyper competitive level. So I could talk to you all about that game, but I can't play that
game.
Dude,
here's my plans for that game. So I'm trying to be a YouTuber, you know, PewDiePie, watch out. And for those of you who don't know who PewDiePie is, I applaud you, and I'm going to keep it that way, because, yeah.
I regret that I know.
You know, I respect the dude. You know, he's just a kid out of somewhere.
Dude, you do your thing. You make your money. Gotta get
right, exactly. So, you know.
Your product just ain't for
right.
me, brother.
You know, so anyways, the $4 million figure, it's attractive. You know, we all want to exercise our dreams, so on and so forth. But one of the things I'm thinking about, and I'll probably get it done since I got a GoPro from my work, and no, I did not get groped, if that sounded that way.
I mean, however you got to get that promotion.
Dude, right?
Yet.
Shit. dollar bills, y'all. But I'm thinking to have Facebook exclusive gaming series, and this would be perfect for it because literally any video could be like 10 seconds long and that would be fine. I read are you familiar with Facebook videos? Do you remember when that first came out last year? So
are you talking about like your profile video?
No. So you know how you can upload like little clips of videos. Not your pro, just like it's a thing. So basically, YouTube had been overcome by Facebook as the number one platform where like over 70-80% of all videos were getting played.
For the record, I'm making a terrible mistake and I'm reinstalling Clash Royale. I will play this game if all my cards and stuff are still here. I don't think I ever set up an account, so they might just all be gone forever.
Dude, just use the same Google Plus account.
If it's tied to my Google Plus account.
Yeah, it forces you to use that account. We should form a clan. That way you can give me your cards, so I don't suck so much, you know.
The trick to being good at a clan is not asking for cards, but when you give other people cards, you get experience and gold, and that's how you make that bank.
Oh, that's pretty dope.
Installing. Anyway, no, please move on past the part where Facebook is the most popular. They ain't paying us. We don't talk about
that. I know,
brother.
But basically, plug warning.
Yo. If you do want it though, Mark Zuckerberg, call me. I can hook you up with some sweet names.
Absolutely. But yeah, what I was thinking, right, so I need to get some exposure. So I was thinking to just have that as a mini series out there in the world.
That's not a good mini series because games can go up to 4 minutes.
True, but I don't know. So here's my thinking, right? Warband, I really enjoy it. I'm going to finish that series and I'm going to play the shit out of it. Absolutely, to infinity. But
why not just stream Clash Royale? That's a very popular stream game.
Actually, I might stream that. But I'm just thinking, so I have one video on my Facebook page, and yes, I did make a Facebook page for my channel, that's got like 10 views. Exciting.
Only 6.9 billion more people to watch it than everyone on the planet.
Dude, I know, but I gotta start somewhere, right? No, but there's like 25 million people playing that game, so, you know, it's a lot more than Warband. And I don't know, do I really want to, you know, I was thinking about also getting into Minecraft, and I really love playing that game. But, you know, there's a lot of people with videos on that. So anyways, I'm just thinking about how do I
expand the movement? How do I get going? Keep it moving. And get that there. So anyone watching, listening, if you have suggestions, no marketers, please, but hit me up.
So anyway, you were going to talk about this game instead of your channel.
Yeah. So yeah, I haven't played a lot of it though. Have you ever played Clash of Clans, the original?
No, I like games where you do stuff and are fun.
Yeah, Clash of Clans.
I played a little bit of Clash of Clans. I played enough of it to say, oh, wow, this is just a game you spend a bunch of time and money in, but you never actually do anything.
Oh, it's one of those? Yeah. I figured it probably was going to be.
Oh, my God. Sorry, this game is starting me in the tutorial. I might be playing Clash Royale right now.
Uh-oh. So, wait, do you...
Oh, wait, what? Wait, do you want to load Liquid's progress?
Oh, yes. Thank God, dude. Could you imagine if you had to start over again? Would you? Would you have started?
No.
Have you ever started a game where you lost the progress?
Oh my God. So, because I'm playing on hard mode, I make a million saves in The Witcher 3. And I'm like 40-some hours into this game right now. But there's no... most games don't have it. There's no batch processing of your save files. So I spent like 20 minutes deleting save files. And you hit X to select delete and A to hit confirm your delete, but if you don't press X first, you press A to load, right? So I accidentally deleted the most recent save file and then loaded another one, and I was like, and then I had to, like, in a panic, download it, because it doesn't go to your recycling bin either, because the game doesn't move it to the recycling bin, it just deletes the file. That's so I had to download I managed to recover the file. But, oh my God, dude, if I had lost, I would have never played that game again if I had lost 40 hours. That has happened to me on a couple games before, and I just say, well, I'm never going to play this video game again.
That's pretty depressing. Wait, well, so, name one.
Let's see. I was replaying Super Mario RPG, lost like 8 hours, never going to play that again.
Wow.
Even though I love that game. I'll probably replay that again, but that was enough to kill the...
To get you where you wanted to go?
That was enough to kill that.
Oh, nice. Real quick, Mountain Blade Warband, 81 hours played.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Dude, I can't wait to get back into it, to be honest.
So, please actually talk to me about Clash
Royale. Oh, yes, Clash Royale. Dude, yeah, I'm only on the second arena. I'm actually just bringing it up right now.
I fell all the way down to arena 6 from arena 8. What happened?
What? How'd that happen?
I guess you lose trophies over time if you don't play. Which makes sense, because in a lot of ranked games are like that, right? Like in Hearthstone, I hit Legend one season, and I stopped at like... We went away for a weekend, and I was legend ranked 332, mm-hmm. meaning that I was the 332nd best player in the right. region. But then I came back, and I had been dropped down to like legend to like 1,000 something.
I mean, that makes sense. And I mean, you lose every time you lose, yeah. You lose trophies.
You can't reserve your spot, basically. You can't camp on the top of the leaderboard
right.
forever.
That makes sense. Real quick tidbit about leaderboards. So, Kim.com, the dude they used to run Mega Upload, mm-hmm. was a top COD player for a little bit on the Xbox, whatever. When he went to jail, mm-hmm. when they finally caught him, he dropped to third place within like a month. I know. He must have been shitting bricks in prison. Well, maybe for other reasons. Anyways, Clash of Clans. Yeah, I'm on the second arena. I got a magical chest to open, a golden one, some free chests.
Did you get any interesting cards?
I mean, nothing. Well, I just got the tombstone. I'm waiting on the magical
tombstone.
One to see.
Play the tombstone, by the way. Have you seen the prince yet?
No, I've seen it. That's the one that has the lance.
Yeah, and you know how he always fucks your shit up,
yeah.
really bad. So here's what you do. Prince costs 5 elixir, uh-huh. right? tombstone costs 3 elixir. If you drop the tombstone in the prince's way, he will stop to attack it. Your tower will be shooting him with arrows. Then prince also attacks units, so 3 skeletons will come out when it dies. They'll start attacking him. He'll have to kill all 3 of them, and then basically what'll happen is for 3 elixir, you killed his 5 elixir dude and took no damage, and now you're 2 elixir ahead of him. Tombstone is
no. That actually sounds
best
pretty good. That's a pretty good strategy.
It works for Mini Pekka also, who you might have seen. He's a little robot dude.
Oh yeah, I got him. I got him on my team. I like him.
Since he gets distracted by units, if you place one of those directly in front of your tower right after they spawn their guy, he'll stop to kill every skeleton, then he'll stop to kill the thing, and then he'll stop to kill it. It's just a really good stall tactic. Like, you have a giant coming your way, drop one of those down, and that'll stall him for 1 or 2 punches, and then the skeleton to get by you some time to spawn more dudes. Tombstone, one of the most underrated cards in the game, in my opinion.
I'm gonna play it. I like the Goblin House. I mean, well, early on in the first arena, it was fine. Now it's just not.
People still use it a lot.
I mean, well, maybe. It's a rare, so it's pretty good. I'll see how many cards I accumulate. Like, right now, I have 24 skeleton cards.
Oh, man. Dude, I have upgraded my minions to such a level that I need 400 to upgrade them again.
Damn. You know what I like? I can't afford the skeleton army.
So I was using skeleton army to deal with Prince, but the problem with that, the reason I don't like skeleton army is so here's the trick to being good at Clash Royale, is you want to deal with what your opponent plays for either equal to but less than they spend on it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And because that puts you ahead, and that means you could just put out more units than they can over the game. If it's called tempo, and I've talked to you about tempo in Hearthstone, it's the same,
right.
The same thing. So, like, for example, Skeleton Army, really good at dealing with a giant, right? Skeleton Army costs 5, giant costs 5, break even. It also deals really well with Prince. But here's what it dies to: Valkyrie in one hit, Valkyrie only costs 4, and it dies to arrows, and arrows only cost 3. So Skeleton Army is kind of a big liability in my books.
Right, but I've had a level 6, and that's maybe just because I'm a low level still. But a level 6 Skeleton Army wipes me every time. Like, in the end of the game.
Do you have a Valkyrie? The chick with the axe that spins
in a
circle?
Yeah, I do.
Kills that instantly.
Right, but no, it's so where they kill me is not when that's all there is, it's just the skeleton army. It's near the end where you get twice the elixirs, and they already start rushing me, and then they just drop that as a, you know, cherry on the ice cream.
So you might just get better over time, right? But the trick to this game is that you cannot win a defensive war. The numbers are tuned in such a way that offense is always greater than defense, which is why I would call it a tower offense game and not a tower defense game. You cannot win by being on the defensive. So if you're already trying to... So it sounds like a lot of the things I'm telling you are reactive defensive plays. You make a couple of them early, then you can make a way big push and they don't have enough elixir to defend. But you can't just win the game by taking a tower and defending. You got to keep pushing.
Yeah, and I mean, in the games that I've won, typically, have been the ones where I keep on the push. More so than not. But I think I'm also at a point where I kind of have to upgrade some of my troops before I can move on. Well, yeah, but this is where I want to record it for what I was talking about, the little Facebook series.
So, before we had some technical difficulties, we were talking about some Clash Royale. Let's talk about some Clash Royale.
Restroom break.
Well, yeah, if you want to put yourself on blast, it's a restroom break.
But yes, Clash Royale. We were talking about that and how Chris was competitively invested.
Yeah, tombstones.
using their tombstones as a stall tactic to crush his opponents. I'm still learning. I just unlocked it today. It's a level one.
Hey,
I
guess
got
what?
One card.
It doesn't matter how many hit points it has. Because a print...
Based on the tombstone?
Because the prince, once he's... You notice he goes slow for a while, then he goes fast, and he has, like, an aura around him. When he has an aura around him, he's going to deal double damage. It's because he's building up momentum. So it doesn't matter how many hit points it has. It's still going to get one-shotted by the prince. What matters is that the prince will stop to attack the skeletons and get shot to death by your tower. The tombstone itself doesn't matter. The skeletons themselves, useless as units. It's just a really good blocking tactic. You can save yourself from a lot of shit that you shouldn't be able to save yourself from using a tombstone.
I see. So the prince is actually really OP then, in a way.
Not really. So, like, later on, like Mini P.E.K.K.A. Mini P.E.K.K.A. has enough health that it won't die to prince. It costs one less than prince, and will probably one-shot a prince.
Yeah, I have him now, and I like him in that matchup. Because the prince will usually... So I have two elixir goblins, right? The spearmen and the regular ones. And while he's focusing on that, the P.E.K.K.A. just wipes them. So for what I have in my deck, it's a pretty good tactic.
I mean, if you don't even need Tombstone then at that point, because you have the goblins. The goblins are probably less good, just because there's only two of them, right?
Well, there's three in it, so it's six total. They both cost two.
Well,
they're level fours right now.
So sword goblin spawns two, spear goblin spawns three. The reason tombstone is good is because it takes one or two hits to kill the tombstone, then three hits to kill the skeletons. It's not a matter of how much damage they do to the prince, as a matter of how many hits it takes him to kill them. And because that increases the amount of time he's getting shot by the tower.
Okay, I see what you mean. So basically it stalls him for a lot longer.
So like a good strategy is they drop a prince, because a lot of people at a low level will open with a prince at the right away, right?
Dude, yeah, I did not.
So what you do is when they open with the prince, you drop the tombstone on that side, and their prince is getting murdered, you drop a P.E.K.K.A. as close to the bridge on the other side as possible. Then when he gets halfway between the bridge and their tower, then you drop your goblins because they're fast, and what'll happen is the turret will be shooting the P.E.K.K.A., and the P.E.K.K.A.'s got a lot of health, so your goblins just fucking murk that tower while the tower is busy with the P.E.K.K.A., and they really can't do jack shit about it because they spent a ton of elixir on the prince.
Yeah, okay, I see that.
So,
and prince five, is what, five?
Five, and tombstone's right? Three. So you have two extra. So that's half of your P.E.K.K.A. already.
That's half of your P.E.K.K.A.
Yeah. I mean, in your case, it's probably your whole P.E.K.K.A., maybe like 1.5 of your P.E.K.K.A.'s, but whatever.
Yeah.
So you're like a Clash Royale?
Yeah, I'm gonna play a lot more, I think.
I'm not really into free-to-play mechanics. Like, some people are into that, right? But, like, I'm not into watching the numbers go up. The thing about Clash Royale, that's what Clash of Clans is, right? It's like playing Diablo, but for people who don't want to play Diablo, you're just watching a bunch of numbers go up. But...
So wait, when you play Clash of Clans, then there's no
battles
or anything.
There might be, but they're not like. It's not like you're playing Age of Empires. You know what I mean?
If I'm not mistaken,
Clash of Clans is like those games you used to play on like Something Awful when you were a kid, where it was entirely text based. You built an army and raided other people, and it's that, but with a graphical interface. And the thing I like about Clash Royale is that not only does it have that, I like card games because I like to maximize, I like to deck, I'm a tinkerer when it comes to deck building, but on top of that, it's just an actually really well-designed game. Like, the part where you play it is really good. Like, I get so invested. Like, if my opponent drops a perfectly timed laughing emote, I just want to throw my phone through the fucking window because I am so invested in that game that I go from, like, a perfectly placed laughing emote makes me go from, like, 0 to 100 instantly.
That's really great. Okay, I'm going to remember that if I ever play you in this.
We should play right after. We can totally play. We'll just have to... So, starting a clan costs, I think, like 2,000 gold. I think I have like 1,300.
I have 340.
And I think I got that Google Play credit to get the other 1,000.
Oh, yeah, so how do you... Can you just go in the store and, like,
spend... No, you can just spend it through the app. Whatever? If you have enough, it's $1.10 because we live in Washington and you pay tax on the stuff that's on the internet.
Yeah, I have $1.12.
Yeah, you should be able to just go get it right now. If you go into the store, you select the 99-cent gem, the payment window will pop up and it should say, use my Google Play balance.
Yeah, I'm logging in right now.
Nothing more exciting than people paying for microtransactions on air. Spoilers, don't use your gems to open chests. Save them, because I think you buy 60 gems for a dollar. And then it's like 40 for 1,000 gold. So you just save those for next time. So every $2 you get through your surveys is 3,000 gold.
Oh, nice. So right now I have 2,000 gems. So just buy the gold.
You just buy gold.
I can buy 1,000 gold. And one more. So it's, you said 2 grand?
I think it's 2 grand. Let's see. Do I have...
Alright, I have 2 grand.
Alright, well, start a clan. Oh, yeah, buying a fistful of gems. This is the least exciting audio where we're both sitting here spending Google Play survey balances on microtransactions.
I'll probably end up cutting that out, right? I mean...
You could. Nah. Alright, so...
This is going to be pure...
What's
raw
your clan
and
name?
Uncut.
I'm just going to, like, I want to fuck you over really quick. You could...
Dude,
you could
what
just call
should
the
it
White
be?
Noise Boys.
Oh, there you go.
Get that...
Nothing like
get that promotion.
Advertising.
We'll talk more about... Okay, well, let's pretend we're back. Right? Because you're going to cut a whole bunch of this.
Yeah.
So... We'll talk more. It sounds like you haven't played enough and you don't have a lot of cards. Maybe after this episode, maybe after we're done recording, I'll kick your shit in, right? Because you have enough gold to start a clan, so we'll start a clan, do a friendly match, and you can lose a bunch, and then I will be the one making the crying emotes. But, yeah, we'll play. I think that's all we got for now. Like, we don't have listener mail right now, right? Because people don't... You should before we record next time, you should go on like a day or two in advance, solicit questions from your Twitter followers for the channel. Maybe we'll take some like listener questions or talk about listener topics or whatever. But that's all I got for today. You got anything interesting?
Yeah, no, that's pretty good.
You got anything interesting coming up on in the week?
There's
anything non-gaming related that you're into lately?
Well, I mean, I'm really excited for The Laughing Joke to come out theaters. I've been really getting into the whole DC.
The Killing Joke? Yeah, that's one of the best Batman comics that's ever been written.
Dude, the best ending,
uh-huh.
Right? Where they're running through the rooftops and the Joker makes that joke. I love it. I don't even want to say it because it's written
also,
so perfectly.
Also, you probably shouldn't because this is also being a movie coming out, so I wouldn't want you to spoil a movie.
True. But, I mean, we can talk about it. What really got me interested in it, because, you know, no questions, I'm going to watch it. No questions, already read it. I own it in hardcover. But the people that were arguing over their ratings and how it's R-rated and it shouldn't be compared to, you know, all the other ones that are out there that are PG-13. And I don't know, we'll leave it for next time. Maybe get into some of those topics too.
Why, sir?
Well, here's a side note, and you should drop a marker. Why don't we just get into it now? Because you're going to chop a ton of this out, because this was a very rough recording, so we probably have time if you want to.
Yeah, let me drop a marker. All right, and we're back. Okay. Talking about
drop another marker.
Joke.
You just pretend that that didn't happen. You don't say, and we're back. You don't want people to know we edited.
Fair enough.
So,
all right, are we ready?
Okay, so just continue talking about the ratings. Talk about how it's R.
All right, so the laughing joke. R-rated movie, I think, for very good reason.
Is it animated?
It's animated. Absolutely, it's going to be the animated universe. And I'm a big fan of those. The Batman v Superman thing. It was a little bit of a letdown. But anyways, it's animated. It's rated R, and the internet was up. You know, it had its panties in a bunch, throwing up a shitstorm because of all the other ones that are way brutal. You know, some people had the opinion or were of the opinion that it, you know, doesn't merit an R-rated.
Well, so here's the thing.
Rating.
Is that, like, as a dude with a kid, I would argue that an R-rating is just not about... The way we handle ratings here is kind of fucked up, right? Like, the only thing that gets you an R-rating here is, like, graphic, very, very, very graphic gore or boning. But I really think that a large portion of ratings should be... content, right? Like, it's an animated cartoon. It's not going to be super gory, but the killing joke is very thematically mature.
Absolutely, and that's why I think, exactly, thank you. That's why I think it's very important that it keeps that R rating, because a lot of the themes and the subject matter that they go over aren't
okay,
for
yeah,
kids.
It's like you wouldn't let your kid watch Saw, but even though it's not gory, you still wouldn't let your kid watch The Road. You know what I mean?
Right. Absolutely. No, you would not. And with the killing joke, I mean, so you have a man that's been thrown into the corner by life. You know, he's trying to figure it out, and so he gets conned by a bunch of dudes to go rob, you know, whatever that is. I don't even know what's in those tubs where the Joker falls into. But anyways, he gets conned into doing something because he's basically at the end of the line, and he fucks up, essentially, loses his family in the process, and loses himself. And then you have basically a madman going around Gotham feeling like it's everyone's fault. And then the shit he does to... I don't know if I want to throw too many spoilers if you haven't read the comic book, but the shit that he does with, you know, James Gordon, his daughter, you know, shooting Barbara.
Mm-hmm.
Stripping him butt naked. I love that scene, by the way, where there's the three little midgets dragging Gordon around butt naked in that circus.
Okay. I haven't read the comic in a long time, so I'm going to take your word for it. I haven't read it since it was contemporary.
Anyways, yeah, I'm just going to leave it at I'll play the trailer, I think.
No, we do not need trailer audio. They're not paying.
Okay. No, not right now, dude. I'm going to cut this out, but
I'm not, please don't. Unless it's
Not right now, dude. Relax. Just during like the end product.
Why? No, that's what I'm saying. Don't. They can look up the trailer if they really care. You can put it in the show notes.
Okay,
but don't play sponsored audio in our podcast because we're not sponsored by them. And at some point, that could be a conflict of interests.
Fair enough. So can we do like a screenshot
just
or
put
something?
It, you know, just put a link to the trailer in the show notes. Because, I mean, it's an RSS feed. You can put whatever fields you want in there. So put that in the description. Keep show notes for the description.
Okay, you can
put up the name.
So wait, dude, are we gonna have any video for this?
At some point, maybe when you can get your fucking shit together on the audio side. we can do it as a live stream on Twitch, then you can play that and then leave a marker and cut it out of the audio version, because it's a real it's not good audio.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's just, so I was going to put this up on YouTube, but I mean, without
right.
a video.
Well, we don't have a video right now, so there's no point.
Well, shit, how are you?
You release it. Did you not research anything about podcasts before you started a podcast?
Not really.
Okay, so you're going to make an RSS feed, host this file, submit it to iTunes. People are using SoundCloud for this, by the way. And then submit your feed to iTunes, and then it'll go up in the iTunes store, and then it'll be available however people get podcasts, like I get mine through Pocket Casts.
Okay.
Probably should have looked into that.
Yeah, okay. I probably should have, huh?
So, drop another marker and finish up your Batman conversation.
Shit, how deep do I want to get into this?
I think you're probably good. Just tell me why you're excited about the animated movie, and then when it's coming out, and you're good.
But yeah, for me, so I'm really excited about this this Batman animated Killing Joke, because it's really staying true to the comic. I mean, it's got that style of drawing, writing.
It was a Frank Miller joint, right?
It's probably going to be... Yeah, it's got all the best actors, basically. You got Kevin Conroy as Batman, Mark Hamill as the Joker. He did the Joker in the game. Tara Strong is Batgirl.
Well, Mark Hamill was also the Joker in the 90s cartoon.
Yeah, exactly. So he's been around. He really does. I mean, hats off to Heath Ledger for his
man, that was fucking stellar, dude.
Yeah, absolutely. I hate that they had to kind of do what they did with the ending, because, you know, he wasn't available to act.
They could have weakened at Bernie's bit.
Yeah. He took a quick little permanent break from that. But Mark Hamill really, I would say he is the Joker, you know, as a the voice, at least.
Yeah, for sure.
Absolutely. It's Alan Moore and Brian Bolland's comic book. So I'm really excited, and they don't have a release date yet, just sometime this year, and it's Warner Brothers, which I'm a big fan of. Well, they've done all the Batmans, so
yeah,
they know what's up. It's going to be great. Everyone should see it. Don't bring your kids to it.
I probably won't see it, I'll be honest. Yeah.
Really? Are you not a fan of DC and all that? Marvel.
It's not that I'm not a fan. It's that I've only got X amount of hours in my life to pump media through my eyeballs. And
fair enough. I'm gonna play some violent music.
Unless with a kid and stuff, like my media time is limited, so I'm gonna spend it on stuff I like. But one way I have been finding a way to sneak in extra time is I've been streaming on the phone in bed before I go to sleep, and late.
Oh, but that's like the worst time.
Who cares? Whatever. Lately, I've been embracing my inner weeb, and I found out Crunchyroll has an app, and I've been watching Mobile Suit Gundam Iron-Blooded Orphans. Are you familiar with Gundam?
Tell me about that. I watched the Gundams back in my tween years, you know? But I've not seen...
So... I realized the other day that I like mecha a lot. So here's the problem. Like, people don't like Gundam because it's mecha. And if they do, that's because Gundam is entry-level mecha. It's kind of like Gundam... Like, Dragon Ball Z is to all anime. It's like where you get into it, right? Gundam is that for mecha. After that, you might move on to something like Big O or Gigantor or Evangelion or something like that.
I liked
Oh, no, Big O's excellent.
I don't even know what it was about it.
Because it was a good show. It was not a show about a giant robot. It was a good show that also had giant robots in it.
Yeah, which is
you know, what you everything right. you ever want in a show.
So
but anyway, so you're iron-blooded
back to Gundam. Gundam is bad at robots. Like, the Gundam robots are bad. When you look at them, there's no thought put into how the machine works. It might as well be a Transformer from the cartoons, right? And that's kind of what they look like. So Gundam is never really good at mecha, but people are into Gundam sometimes because it does really good. Some of the series were good at world building. And Iron Blooded Orphans is interesting. I'm going to reveal that I looked at a wiki and I know slightly more about Gundam than I should. And that Iron Blooded Orphan is the farthest Gundam along the latest timeline. So it takes place after some event called the Calamity War, where there's like a massive war between. So space is colonized, and there was a massive war between Earth and their fort, their setup, and everyone else. And you never actually see any of that. And this is all about post-war society, where something like Mars is like an industrial slave supplying like the 1% who live on Earth.
That's funny. So that the 1% kicked everyone out.
Oh yeah.
Stayed on
so
Earth.
Like, the show really focuses great. On like a bunch of war orphans, who have had like forcibly undergone, who have been forced to undergo surgery so that they can pilot. They're like not mechs. They're like mech suits. They're mobile workers. So they're basically like forced to get shit implanted into their spine, and like a bunch of kids die from it. Only like 30% of them live. That way they can just do like hard manual labor, like lifting shipping containers with these mech suits. So it's got a really, really bleak atmosphere, and it's focused a lot on politics. There happen to be cool robot fights in it. But even though the robots themselves aren't that cool, the music and the choreography in this one is excellent. And it's got a really dark and depressing tone, which is a thing that is a common element in things that I like. So I would say that it's a pretty good anime, even if you're not necessarily into giant robots. And I would check it out. It's on Crunchyroll. Thanks to Crunchyroll's got really bad ads, though. They're all for, like, Showtime, and there's, like, four of them for Showtime in a row. But...
Oh, that's horrible.
Oh, man. It's you think Hulu's bad about playing the same ads for the same company over and over and over? This one is literally, hey, check out the same ad four times in a row.
That's really bad.
But other than that, I would definitely give it a shot. If you're even a little bit into anime, or if you've never seen an anime, it's worth watching. It's a little overdramatic, like all anime is, because anime characters tend to be a representation of a single emotion in the extreme, which is why it's always so overdramatic. But beyond that...
Right, but I enjoy it for that, honestly. I like that
extremism. It's as the world turns for nerds. That's really what anime is. It's kind of like how wrestling is anime for white trash.
Yep, you know, you said
true.
That before, and that really describes
it. It's true. It's really true. There's 30 minutes of white
that.
Dudes yelling at each other, over-exaggerated, about some made-up, contrived bullshit. That sounds like anime. And then instead of giant robots suits fighting, you have just a bunch of dudes who are, like, way jacked.
And as they punch each other,
they yell really loud like an anime character. One day, instead of like the Undertaker's just gonna yell Kamehameha as he dropkicks some dude.
Yeah, basically. You know what I love best though is back in the old school days where they're punching each other and you can see how they're hitting their own bicep. so great.
Don't be breaking kayfabe, bro. I accidentally revealed that I know what kayfabe is, and now I feel terrible.
I don't even know
kayfabe is the illusion of wrestling. It'd be like a wrestler breaking character and revealing that wrestling is not real for a moment. That's the kayfabe. You don't break kayfabe, brother. You pretend that wrestling is real at all times. I don't even know where I learned that. But yeah, check out Iron Blooded Orphans. Yeah. I'm into it. Even if Gundam is bad at robots, you're not there for the robots. The robots just happen to be there. The music is really good. There's a lot of like Celtic instrumentation a lot, which is really interesting.
That's really interesting for that.
The fighting choreography is kind of like Knights of Cydonia in terms of there's a really really good sense of motion and momentum. It's pretty good.
I'll consider it. You know, I'm not sure how much free time I have.
You can watch it in bed. That's the trick is that you just roll over with your back to your family, and then watch anime on your phone.
But that's how I play my Clash of Clans, man. Bro.
That's why I have made it to like episode 4, then didn't watch any for like a month because Clash Royale, and then I watched a bunch, and then lately I've been falling asleep early, but now that I reinstalled Clash Royale, God knows when I'll watch these last 6 episodes.
Oh wow, it's only 10 episodes too?
It's
that 26. Might be watchable.
It's the standard.
Oh, that's still not too bad.
You'll know, I would say, I think it's like... You'll know by like the third episode. If you're kind of sold, I think I might go to 5, but by then you'll really, really know. It's
okay. Well, I'll see.
Yeah, it's not like an Evangelion where the real show doesn't start until like episode 14.
Yeah, that's why I never got into that one, because so a friend of mine had like the first season or whatever. And I watched it one time, and yeah, I just, it was like,
oh my God.
What the hell am I watching?
That makes me really upset. I do not watch almost any anime because I don't understand people who are fans of anime in general, right? Because that's like saying I'm really into, I like all comic books, right? It's an artistic medium. It's not a hobby, it's a medium. You can enjoy that medium, but like all mediums, 90% of it is garbage, and that's why I feel bad for people who only watch anime and are really into it. I don't think there's enough... it might be. It depends on how broad your tastes are, but personally, not even close to enough anime for me to just watch anime all the time, right? But like...
Yeah, no, I could. I mean, there's shows I enjoy, and there's certain themes I think throughout my shows that I enjoy. But yeah, not
yeah.
At all.
But despite not liking anime in general, really, because I'm not into the artistic medium. For me, anime is just another way of conveying stories, or showing themes that I like. So, for example, big themes for me are cyberpunk, horror, and now I discovered mecha. But despite not really liking anime, I will tell you that Neon Genesis Evangelion is probably my favorite media experience across all mediums. Like music, movies, art,
really?
TV. Check it out. Watch the whole
Interesting.
Thing. I know that's okay. A big ask because it's like 8 hours, but watch the whole thing.
Yeah, you know, I'm probably going to... I'll think about that. I mean, I might even get started on that.
You could do it in a Saturday.
Yeah, but I could also play Warband in a Saturday, and right now Saturdays are my only days, so we'll see. All right,
well, my baby just woke up, so now seems like a good time to wrap this up. I don't know when this will be going up, but hopefully Aleksandar will figure out how to make an RSS feed and upload that, as we probably should have researched beforehand, and we'll...
You got any tips on that real fast?
Google SoundCloud. Probably don't even...
I'll just drop it on there.
Well, no. There's a way to get RSS feeds from SoundCloud, and the RSS feed is what you upload to the iTunes Store, because almost every podcasting app uses the iTunes Store as the database and reference for all feeds.
Sweet. Well, I'm gonna sign in to SoundCloud. Get that set up.
While that happens, in the meantime, we will be back one day, because we don't even know when this one's coming out, and hopefully by next week, once we figure some stuff out, we will know what our schedule is like. But in the...
Yeah, and we'll definitely let all our watchers know. And we do appreciate all the support. So if you do find this,
by the way, we're not video right now. I just wanted to. Our readers.
Anyways,
thank you, readers.
If you do find this, thank you. Thank you, readers.
So yeah, this has been the inaugural. You could probably tell it has definitely been the first episode of the White Noise Boys. I've been your host, Chris.
It took us about 2 weeks to get together on this.
I am trying to close this episode. Oh my god.
All right, find us on YouTube at The Liquid Sword.
No.
Is that your Twitter?
I am the host. I will do this. You respond when I... You got it? You just shut your fucking mouth.
Fuck. I'm not going
to
cut it.
That's fine. We're going to do it again. I want this to be in here so they know what I've been dealing with. This episode will probably be an hour and 15 minutes long, but we've already been recording for 2 hours. So I want... No,
Dude, you shut your whore mouth.
They need to understand what I have gone through. All right, well, that's... That's all for the first episode of the White Noise Boys. I've been your host, Chris Taylor, and you have been...
Lord Petrie, Aleksandar, man, the myth, the legend. Okay, I'm going too far.
And,
I'm Aleksandar, Lord Petrie.
You can find me in my web design portfolio. Please don't look at it right now. I'm working on it, but it'll be done one day at Chris Taylor. That's christaylor.zone. Pretty dank URL. And
the best URL.
Sometimes I stream
really.
at twitch.tv/ Liquid Swordsman 1. And where can they find you?
You can find me right now on YouTube, the channel that I've started, the Madbox channel, on Twitter, @MadboxChannel. Pretty frequently on there, 87 followers. You know, we're going strong, even though all the accounts are fake, but don't worry about that.
Is that all? Is that all your plugs? This is where you do the plugs. All of the plugs.
Oh yeah, the plugs. All of the plugs. I'm gonna have to fix my plugs, so I can
write them down
up next time. Yeah, I'll write them down. But yes, the YouTube channel is what I want you to know about. So check me out on YouTube, the Madbox channel. Google it. I've got pretty good SEO, so I'm gonna find it.
Okay. That I'm glad that the
one of my friends is an asshole.
I'm glad the thing you chose to advertise about your YouTube channel is not. We've got great videos and interesting commentary. We've got good SEO. That's the most notable thing about.
Dude, I only have 8 videos, okay, and it's Warband, less than 100.
The most
channel
notable
views,
thing
so.
About your channel is that you've got good SEO. Nice. Alright, well that's all for today. We're signing out, and this is where if Aleksandar wanted to try, there would be some sound of some static. We're going. We out.